participated thus far, the more I think about what church is and what church should be, and thinking about some of the things we talked about this morning, it's a community of believers. And it isn't one person, certainly not me, that makes a church and that makes even a worship service. And I thank you so much for just the folks that are willing to help and to participate, just not just today, but week after week. All right, so we are going to be, I'm going to throw you a kind of a curveball in this sense. Normally, when I am filling in, I get to sort of pick whatever I want. I decided, Daniel and I talked and decided, you know what, we've been in Luke for about 18 years, and it's about time to get this over. No, I'm just kidding. Who's probably watching right now? So we are going to be continuing in Luke, okay? So we're going to be continuing in Luke, specifically Luke chapter 11, in verse 33. We're going to go 33 through 36. So not a lot of passage, but a very meaningful passage. Before we read, I do want to just maybe give brief outline and maybe even a little bit of a context, and I'll probably get that out of order. You see me shuffling papers already. This is a really small, when you have lots of stuff, this seems to shrink down even more. Like I feel like it's a size of a stamp or something like that. Anyway, so what are we going to be talking about today? What we're going to be talking about is that Jesus has been God's clear and plain plan of salvation since the beginning of time. He's not a secret. It's not been a secret that we somehow have, that we hold, and that we've all got to just, you know, peek at, okay? It's something that has been evident since that beginning. He is the light of the world. That's who Jesus is. That's who he says who he is, and that's what we're going to be talking about a little bit. And this isn't new, and it's not different, and it's not something that we haven't spoken about before or something that we won't speak out again about again. But what it is revolutionary. And I don't want to say, you know, we think about things that are not new, that are repeated, and somehow that has a staleness to it. Not this. It's as revolutionary today as it was when he said it. And I want us to understand that as we go through it, okay? So that's going to be sort of our bottom line. Jesus was God's plan of salvation from the beginning, okay? So now let's read the scripture here, if I can not lose my place, which I seem to have done already. That's strike one. All right, here we go. So Luke chapter 11, verse 30, beginning at verse 33. No one lights a lamp and puts it in a place where it will be hidden or under a bowl. Instead, he puts it on its stand so that those who come in may see the light. Your eyes, depending on your translation there, your eye is the lamp of your body. When your eyes are good, your whole body is also full of light. But when they are bad, your body is also full of darkness. See to it, then, that the light within you is not darkness. Therefore, if your whole body is full of light and no part of it is dark, it will be completely lightened, as when the light of a lamp shines on you. Lord, thank you for this scripture. Thank you for this passage. Lord, thank you personally. Thank you for the opportunity to be here and to speak about your word and just to share. What an incredible opportunity and responsibility this is, and I thank you for that. Lord, as Susie mentioned, not me, but you, Lord, let you speak through this scripture. Let you be glorified through this scripture. And Lord, just help me to say the words that you would have me to say. And Lord, we love you. In your son Christ's name we pray. All right, so talking lots about light. Let's think about a little bit of the context before we break this down. So if you remember what we learned, what we talked about last week, Jesus is speaking to the crowd. And this crowd is growing. Okay, it's getting bigger. Okay, Jesus is performing miracles, and they are growing bigger. And then they start to accuse him of things. They start to accuse him, for instance, of performing these miracles using the power of the devil. And what does he do? He rebukes them. He defines and he defends his authority. And what do the people do? How do they respond? They still demand more miracles. Show us your tricks, okay? And it's why are they asking this? Again, they're not looking to have more evidence or more proof. He gives that, right? He gives that. He defends it. They're wanting to see more of this power that he has. And what did we, again, what was one of the lessons that we learned last week? Again, we talked about Jesus defending his authority, but we also talked about that we have to recognize it. And that if we don't, we are condemned. Okay? There is a recognition that must take place or we are condemned. Those who fail to believe are condemned. They are the only ones that are condemned. If we believe, we are not. So Luke 33, let's read that one more time. No one after lighting a lamp, and I'm switching sort of versions here, my apologies there. No one after lighting a lamp puts it in a cellar or under a basket, but on a stand so that those who enter may see the light. My dad loves flashlights. And when I say my dad loves flashlights, I mean he has an absolute love affair with flashlights. Yes. My son Nathan says, amen. Grandpa loves the flashlight. And it's true. It's almost comical, you know. You open a random drawer and there are flashlights fall out and hit you, you know, or something like a TV show. And we're not talking the inexpensive flashlights that you buy at Dollar General. We're talking high-end, potentially blinding flashlights, okay? Why? And one of the things he always is looking for, and let me say, this is apparently a genetic thing that's been passed down. I, too, love flashlights. Maybe not to the extent that he does, but they're a valuable tool. The brighter, the better. Okay, that's the thing. Like I said, I want a flashlight that has a warning on it that says, if you look at this flashlight, see a retina specialist immediately, okay? Right? If it doesn't say that, it's probably not powerful enough. How do we measure brightness of a flashlight? Well, do you remember the old mag lights? Big, it weighed about 10 pounds, mag light. It had, you know, 4 D cell batteries in it. How bright? Anybody know how bright that is? Okay, about 87 lumens. You're sitting there going, what's a lumen? It's a measure of brightness. Well, 87 of those sounds like a lot, right? It's a lot, right? So the flashlight that I have, I didn't bring it. Again, I don't want to damage anybody's eyesight, right? But the flashlight that I have, the one that I primarily use, is 1,200 lumens. Okay, 1,200 lumens. And that's not even the standard anymore. If I were to go and purchase that same line of flashlight, that same model, or the newer version of that model today, I want to say that the basic is either, it's between 1,800 and 2,000 lumens now. So that's a bright flashlight, okay? These old mag lights that you had to have like a battery pack on, 87, that's nothing, right, compared to what we have now. And in my dad's mind and in my mind, more light is obviously better, okay? The brighter, the better. Why would I go in the reverse direction? If I have this flashlight that's very, very bright, why would I then go buy an older, less bright flashlight? That doesn't make any sense, right? Why would I say, I'm not going to use this one over here that shows me everything. I'm going to choose to use this less bright one over here. In fact, those flashlights have usually multiple settings. I can't recall ever putting it on the not highest setting. Like, why does it even have that? It should be the brightest or nothing, right? And Jesus is, I've got y'all hopped up on flashlights, but think about it in a similar way, okay? Jesus is saying, why would we have a light and then not use it? Why would God create this light and then not show it to anybody? So he's sort of saying, why would somebody light a candle probably like 50 lumens or something like that, put it, and then put it under a basket where no one could see it. So, I'm kind of giving it away a little bit, but verse 33, my first point here, who is the light? What is the light that we're talking about? Is it, again, he's just talking about candles? He went to somebody's house and they lit this candle and they put it under a basket and he's annoyed about it? Or is it something more? I think it's something more. Who is the light? What is the light? Well, I would argue that he's referring to himself. And I think that's pretty evident. Some resources will suggest that the light is perhaps the Word of God, perhaps the Bible. But as we know, think about John 1:1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So when we talk about Jesus referring to himself, is it the Word of God or is it him? There's a similar theme here, okay? The Word was with God, the Word was God. Jesus is referring to himself. And he refers to himself, or is referred to in the Bible as light in other places. Think about John 8:12. Again, Jesus spoke to them saying, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. John 9:5. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. So in verse 33 here, when he speaks of this light, at least to me, it's pretty clear that he's speaking about himself. And again, he says, I need to like highlight this because I keep losing it here. But no one puts this light, Jesus, in a place where it will be hidden or under something. No one puts it away. No one lights this light and puts it away. So if Jesus is the light, if this is true, God isn't going to hide him from people. Okay? Just in the same way that you don't turn a flashlight on to then not use it, or you don't choose a less bright light, God isn't going to put this light into the world and then hide him from other people. That makes no sense. In a similar fashion, no sane person would put a light under a basket. And again, my dad would not choose a dim setting. Even more, the God of redemption who loves us would not hide the greatest light that the world would ever see. And this is why it's so perplexing that the people clamored for more signs. So go back to the context. He's saying that I am the light of the world, and you keep begging for more signs. I'm the sign. I am that light. Why do you need more? And why would God not make it abundantly evident to you that I am that person? So it's perplexing. They clamored for more signs when they had the living Son of God in front of them. God was not hiding his intentions. He was casting a bright light right in front of them. The crowd didn't see it. The Jewish leaders tried to hide it. He had already performed a number of miracles, casting out demons, healing the sick, feeding the multitude, amongst others. And it is similarly perplexing when we, people of today, fail to see who Jesus is. Is it not? I mean, so again, if the God of the world, the author of the world, sends his light down to be with us and we don't see it, it's confusing, it's disorienting. And there's no excuse because it's will. It's a choice. Romans 1:19-23, and I know Brother Daniel read this passage last week, but I think it is poignant and I think it has context for what we're going to be talking about today, or what we're talking about today too. For what can be known about God is plain to them, because God has shown it to them. For his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world in the things that have been made, so they are without excuse. For although they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks to him, but they became futile in their thinking and their foolish hearts were darkened. They didn't see the light, so their hearts were darkened. The opposite of light is dark. When we don't have the light, we have darkness. And we'll talk about that. claiming to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images resembling mortal man and birds and animals and creeping things. It is a willful choice, and we choose not to see him. Verse 34. Your eye is the lamp of your body. When your eyes are good, your whole body also is full of light. But when they are bad, your body is also full of darkness. So let's go to point number two here. We are made to receive this light. So if God sends the light into the world, he sends Jesus into the world, his plan of redemption is plain for us to see. And really, that's what we're designed to see. Okay, so again, kind of going back to that idea of choice, it's sort of, he talks about it again here. We are made to receive Jesus. We are made to receive his light, okay? Our bodies are made to receive Jesus' light. It is the natural order for us to do so and to submit to him. In a similar way that our eyes were made to see the light on the lampstand, our hearts are made to see the light of Jesus. When we're born, as we develop and we grow, when our eyes are healthy, when they're functioning, and I believe some of you, if you're using ESV, it'll say healthy. It doesn't say good, it says healthy. When our eyes are healthy, we take in the information around us. Okay? We're able to use that information to process our world. That is what a healthy eye provides. Okay? When it's not healthy and we can't take that information, there's something wrong. It presents a challenge to life. So in a similar way that our eyes were made to see light, our hearts are made to see Jesus. Now, don't misunderstand what I'm saying in the sense that it is somehow not our fault when we can't, right? So when we talk about light in the physical sense, if there's a medical condition, it's not something that we do, right? It's something that occurs naturally. Okay? Cataracts, various cancers, different things can cause us, our eyes to not be healthy, okay? In this sense, it's a choice. God is making us to receive Jesus. Okay? And when we don't choose to see Jesus, we are choosing blindness. And if we are blind, it's not the work of the Lord who has put his lamp on a stand for all to see. It is because it is, again, a choice that we made. What is the outcome of that choice? Well, we're in right relationship with the Lord. So if God is plain to us, and if we are made to receive him, then that is the proper order of things, of our life. And when we have that, we are in right relationship with the Lord. We talked about it in Sunday school. We talked about the fruits of the Spirit. We exhibit those fruits when we are in that right relationship. We are filled with his glory. But when we choose the opposite, when we choose blindness, our bodies are darkened. We are apart from him. Think back to Romans. I mentioned it a moment ago. Romans chapter 1. What is the opposite? When we don't recognize God, our hearts are darkened and we become foolish. Our actions are futile. Our thinking is futile. We become fools. We exchange the glory of the immortal God for other things, he speaks about it here, mortal man and birds and animals and creeping things, but things that are unworthy of our worship and our time and our praise. That is what we are exchanging. We become that. Ultimately, that leads to death. So what we are choosing in exchange for God's glory is we're choosing death. That is the choice we have to make. God gives his light, we can choose it, and when we choose the opposite, we are choosing death. Matthew 6:24, no one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he'll be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money, but you cannot be a you cannot have a master, you cannot have two masters. You cannot choose to serve God and choose this other thing over here. When we our bodies are in right relationship with the Lord, when our hearts are in right relationship with the Lord, it is a consuming thing. When we see that light, we take it in and it fills us up. And when we don't see it and it doesn't fill us, something else will take its place. It says there, when your eyes are bad, your body is full of darkness. So you either choose the light and you choose to be filled with it, or you choose darkness and you choose to be filled with that. 11:35. We're moving right along here, by the way. I don't know how Pastor Daniel does this, right? I feel like I got a tap dance at some point. I tried to think of a funny joke to give you back, but I got nothing there. All right, 35 and 36 here. See to it then that the light within you is not darkness. Therefore, if your whole body is full of light and no part of it dark, it will be completely lightened, as when the light of a lamp shines on you. So it's a guide, but it's also a warning, right? See to it that the light within you is not darkness. How can light be dark? Well, we just talked about it. The light is God. It is God's glory. It is Christ. And if we don't have that, it can be darkness, okay? When we choose to be the fools that is spoken of, that are spoken about in Romans, it's confusing. We are unable at that point to see properly, right? So see to it then that the light within you is not darkness. So if we choose not to receive Jesus and we choose something different, we are filled with that darkness, but we have to be careful to make sure that we make the right decision, okay? All right. So not only is Jesus the light, not only is it our choice to make it, but we are, and not only are we designed to receive that light, but we're also designed to reflect that light. Our bodies are in proper order when we have Jesus' light and we reflect it. Basically just did a Google search for different lights, lamps, other such things, and if you can see the slide here, take a look at this particular one. It's got a shade around it, or not a shade, but it's got I guess that would be the right word. It's got a diffuser, a shade, something around it, right? Why is that? We have those to disseminate the light, right? Even the flashlight that I have, even the flashlight that's, 1,200 lumens, it still has that little reflective plate around the back, and it still has a lens on it. Why is that? Is it that the light isn't bright enough? No, it's that design of that flashlight is to spread that light as far and as wide as it possibly can. In a similar way, the lamp that you see here on the slide, or I guess back here for you all, has a similar function. Its job is to not just receive that light, not to just put it out, but to reflect it and to push it out as far and wide as it possibly can, to illuminate as much of the room as it possibly can. That is us. That is our responsibility, to illuminate the world, to spread that light of Jesus throughout the world. Okay, Matthew 28:19-20. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. He tells us to go, right? So to go therefore and make disciples. It is our job when we recognize God's plan, when we recognize that light, when we take it in, to then reflect it to the communities around us. Again, even the brightest flashlights have a lens and reflectors. We become a luminary. We refuse to let the world put us under a basket, as it talks about here. We don't hide the light that we now have. We shine it. We reflect it to others. finding like, I'll go up here and I see 24, and then I go over here and I have 47, and I'm like, okay, and then I kind of find it down here. So if your whole body is full of light and no part of it dark, it will be completely lightened as when the light of the lamp shines on you. So when we have the fullness of Christ's relationship, when we have we are in right relationship with Him, what is our primary purpose? It is then to make disciples, to help others to recognize that same light. And this is what Jesus is saying here, okay? We refuse to take this light, we refuse to hide it, we refuse to put it under something. It becomes who we are. We become the lamp. We become the lamp reflecting the light of Christ. So what do we do with this? And what's the challenge? Is it that simple? In some respects, yes, right? So to the believer, look at your own life. Are you full of the light? Are you full of Christ? Are you reflecting it? The message that you have, the saving relationship with Christ, are you putting it under a basket? Am I? Or are you reflecting it? Are you living a life that leads people to Jesus? Are you actively telling people about Jesus? Are you making disciples, as he says? Are you praying for opportunities to meet and to tell people about Jesus? And this is something right here in our own church. Look at the world around us. Look where we are. If this place doesn't need the light of Christ, I don't know where it does. What are we doing to that end? Are we hiding the light? Or are we sharing it with the community around us? Are we praying for opportunities to share? If you're not, are you sure that you have it? If you're not doing these things, then what do you have? Are you that person who has the healthy eye and who has seen the light and is consumed by it? Or, as it says, do you have the darkness? Are you confused? Are you mistaken? Do you have darkness? If you aren't beaming bright with the light of Jesus Christ, what are you beaming with? The world is full of darkness, full of blindness, but each one of us has the light, the power, and the authority to extinguish that darkness. So again, to the believer, examine your life. What is it that it is about? What is it that you are telling other people with your actions and your words? To the unbeliever, what is your life about? Have you asked yourself what's inside? Do you have a purpose? Do you have joy? Do you have a knowledge that death isn't the end for you? Do you have can you say, as we talked about, or as we sang about, that it is well with your soul? Can you say that? Or do you have emptiness? And do you have darkness inside? The flashlight that if I could critique myself, just an aside, about this sermon, I think I talked probably a little too much about the flashlights. But I really wanted to make sure I had a good illustration. And you're probably all like, what, did he bring it? No, I didn't. I didn't want that to be distracting. But anyway, the flashlight that I have, the one that gives off 1,200 lumens, it can light up the field next to our house. If you've been to our house, there's a massive field with a tree line that's far off in the distance right next to it. And when that flashlight is on and it is fully charged, I can see the trees across the field. And at nighttime, there's deer there, and I can see them. And I can see them pretty well. You can see their eyes, you can see, you can even sometimes determine, is this a doe or is it a buck? When that flashlight is on long enough, it gets hot. And it starts to warm your hand. But when it's off, boy, is it off. That field is so dark. And it especially too, when I'm outside and maybe I haven't charged and it cuts off on its own, I'm suddenly reminded of how cold the darkness is and how you really can't see anything. I go from being able to see 100 yards away, I can count deer, to not being able to see what's directly in front of me. It's thick, it's cold, and there's nothing. But when that light is on, that darkness is gone. It's extinguished. The flashlight is warm in my hand. I can see. Where are you? What do you have? Do you have that flashlight? Or do you not? If you are here today and you have doubts about that question, if you're thinking about what you have inside and you're not sure, you're thinking about what you have inside, maybe you are sure. Maybe you know you don't have it. Maybe you know you've never accepted Christ. Change that now. Change it today. Don't live in the cold black of this earth 1 minute longer. Commit your life to Christ. He is right there. He's revealed himself to you. Don't ask for more signs. You have them, and you know it. He's right there. And he wants to have a relationship with you. Don't extinguish the light. Don't hide it. Don't hide from it. Accept it. If you have questions, if you are not sure, please see somebody. It can be me. It can be any number of people here. But do so today. As we end the service, as we go into this last song, I want all of us again to think about what our lives are about. As you go throughout this week, think about what your life is about. Take a personal inventory. What are you doing to reflect Jesus? What are you doing outside of this church building to bring glory to God?